Amy Turner, and today I'm going to talk to you about tartini tones. Now you may ask yourself, what is a tartini tone? Well, when two different notes of differing frequencies are played at the same time, a third note below those two can be heard. This note is called a tartini tone. So we'll start with a little history, then we'll move into the physics behind it, and then we'll finish with an experiment.
It all started with Tartini. He was an Italian Baroque composer and violinist, most well known for this song, Devil's Trill Sonata. In 1726, Tartini started a violin school, became a consumed music theorist, and was credited with the discovery of difference tones. He published his observations in 1754. Unfortunately, it received little attention until the 1800s when a group of physicists became intrigued by Tartini's observations. It was well known at the time that the vibrations of a string or column of air produce a tone corresponding to its fundamental frequency, and provides a series of harmonics. Furthermore, if two tones differing in frequency sounded together, beats were produced resulting from the interference of the two tones. Tartini's observations of difference tones showed that when two tones of different frequencies were played together, a lower tone was produced, although it was barely distinguishable with frequency F1 minus F2. This tone does not belong to the harmonic series. Scientists such as Lagrange and Young postulated that if the beat frequency is large enough, it could be recognized as a tone itself, producing a difference tone. In the late 1820s, Weber supported the beat theory that Young and Lagrange had produced earlier, but added to their theory, suggesting that more than one of these beat tones was audible. In 1832, Hallstrom challenged the beat theory by stating that these tones were due to the nonlinearity of the human ear. Therefore, not only the fundamental frequencies of tones could produce difference tones, but their harmonic partials should produce difference tones as well, such as these. Unfortunately, at the time, the tones that Hallstrom predicted were not observed. In 1843, Ohm came out with his acoustic law that stated, a musical sound is perceived by the ear as a set of a number of constituent pure harmonic tones, something like a Fourier analyzer. This received little attention at the time until Helmholtz in 1856 published a paper on combination tones, discussing difference tones in particular, arguing against the beat theory. Helmholtz was able to demonstrate that combination tones should occur and be detectable when two tones of large enough intensity are played together. But what did he mean by large enough? He meant that the nonlinear square term describing the displacement of the cochlea had to overcome the linear term affecting the motion of the cochlea. He stated, I therefore believe that I am able to put forward the conjecture that it is the characteristic form of the tympanum that determines the formation of a combination tone. Helmholtz's conjecture is still the forerunning theory today.
Now that you know the history, it's time to know the physics.
We will start simply by looking at the motion of your cochlea under one driving frequency. If you look at the equation of motion, you find all the usual terms plus a nonlinear squared term, k times x squared. This is due to the material of your cochlea. Initially, it is relatively easy to vibrate, but as the displacement becomes bigger, it becomes harder to drive. To solve this nonlinear differential equation, we will guess x to equal cosine of omega drive t. Now when we plug this back into our equation of motion, assuming the cochlea is driven hard enough for the nonlinear term to become significant, we can analyze the squared term. This term provides cosine of 2 omega drive t plus a rectification term, derived from trig and complex analysis. This shows that if an ear is driven at omega drive, the nonlinearity of the cochlea will cause a tone at 2 omega drive to be heard. But what if our guess for x is not accurate enough? This time, we will guess x to have two terms. As you can see, when the nonlinear squared term becomes significant, now things get messy. Many more terms are produced. But we clearly get multiples of the fundamental driving frequency. Now let's look at the case with two driving frequencies, omega 1 and omega 2. We will make our guess to include a cosine term for each frequency. Now if we analyze the nonlinear term, things get interesting. This is where Tartini tones appear. As you can see from the middle term, we get a frequency that looks like omega 1 minus omega 2, hence a Tartini tone appears. But where does Hallstrom's hypothesis of multiples of frequencies combining come from? If we make a better guess, the nonlinear term will become quite messy, but the terms that Hallstrom predicted then appear.
Now that you know all about Tartini tones, it's time to actually hear them. This is my setup. I have a wave function generator connected to two different speakers. They will both be producing only sine waves. This one is set at 1,000 hertz, and this one is set at 1,500. Now, you may be wondering why I have another set up completely. I've also set one up to be at 500 so that I can play the tone that you should be hearing so that you can compare it to what you think you hear. First of all, I'll play just the 1,000, and then I'll play the 1,500, and then I'll play them together so that you have an opportunity to hear the difference tone, and then I'll play the note that you should be hearing, and then I'll give you another chance to find it and to hear it. So I will play first the 1,000. Now the 1,500. Now I'll play them together. Now hopefully you could hear the difference tone, but if you can't, this is the tone that you should be hearing. I'll give you another try.
Remember, Tartini tones only appear when your cochlea is driven at a high intensity. So if you don't hear the Tartini tone, consider turning up the volume on your computer.
So I made another setup. If you were a music person, the last two notes that I played were a fifth apart. I set these ones up so that now they're a third apart. One of them plays at 1,000 again, and one of them plays at 1,250 hertz. So if you do the math, this one I set up to play 250, the difference tone that you'll hear from these two. So I'm going to do it just like last time. I'll play one, then the other, then I'll play them together, and then I'll show you the tone that you should hear, and then I'll play them together again. So here we go. I'll show you the tone that you should hear. I'll play them together again. Well, I hope you enjoyed learning about Tartini tones.